Good morning and a very warm welcome to Our Mornings. Today is Friday the 28th of August. I'm Birgit and as always it is so lovely to be with you on this Friday before the Summer Bank holiday weekend, and I hope that you have lots of lovely plans to look forward to for the weekend ahead. And in the meantime we have a very exciting program planned for you. We are beginning with our verse for the day and then a beautiful worship song by a lovely Christian duo called Mary Mary. Before we turn to the daily newspapers and the stories that we're waking up to this morning, we're going to be looking at everything from the effects of the Chinese stock market crash through to the sounds of the universe and some sage advice from a 100-year-old man on the secrets to a long life. All of that coming up in part one, and then in part two we have our viewer discussion, which is on the topic of Christians and exercise this morning. We're asking the question, how important should exercise be to Christians? And we'd love to hear your thoughts on this. Do you think that exercise should be a priority in the Christian life, or do you think that it's something that can possibly take away from our focus on Christ-likeness and pursuing serving the kingdom of God? Do you exercise? And maybe you have a testimony about the way that by integrating more exercise into your life that you have had health benefits come from that. Also, if you know of any Bible verses that has helped your perspective when it comes to exercise, health and fitness, it would be wonderful to hear from you on any of those things. Do keep your emails and texts coming in from the beginning of the program. And if I could just ask you, we love receiving your input on the programs. If it's possible to keep your emails just to about a paragraph, that would really help us, because we love to read as many as possible, so that would help us to get through as many of your messages as we can. That would be wonderful. Do also send in your prayer requests. It would be so lovely to lift your needs before the Lord in part two of the program today. So all of that in store on Our Mornings this morning, and joining me to discuss all of this is our friend and my co-host, Dr. Richard Kent. Richard, welcome to Our Mornings.
Oh, it's just lovely to be here with you again. Good morning, Becky.
Good morning. Well, Richard, can I start off by asking you the question, do you exercise?
Oh, absolutely. Every day, actually. Either go for a run around the block or walk mostly, or go to the gym every day. One or the other, but I love it.
Well, that's amazing that you've actually just, you know, that you're so focused on that it's such a part of your lifestyle. It sounds like you're very disciplined in that whole area.
Well, you are. just in case you didn't know, Birgit's a fitness instructor and she's knows much more about all this than I do. What about you, Birgit? Do you lots and lots of exercise?
I should just say about that, though, that my fitness instructing days were quite a long time ago. I qualified about 12 years ago and I was instructing around that time. So it's been about 10 years since I've done that. But I have a lifelong love of health and fitness and exercising, so I do still love going to the gym and doing a lot of walking actually as well. I really,
lovely.
Really enjoy that.
Yes,
so we can talk more about that actually as we go through the program. Mm. But that's great to know that you do it every day, Richard. It's wonderful. And it's a great lead-in actually to our verse for the day. I wonder if you'd be able to read that for us.
Certainly will. I think it might come up on the screen, you never know. Oh, here we go. It's actually in 1 Timothy 4, verse 8. For bodily exercise profits a little, but godliness is profitable for all things, having promise of the life that now is and of that which is to come. So there we are. Bodily exercise profits a little, but godliness is what we're after, because it profits us from now in this present life and also in the life to come. Now, I'm not going to say very much about it, especially since Birgit's a fitness instructor, so I'm going to ask Birgit's thought on this straight away.
Well, I just think this verse is really, really helpful to help us to begin thinking about this whole topic, because what the Apostle Paul is pointing out is really how much of a priority exercise should be. And his answer really is that we need to take a balanced approach to this. And I really like that. As with many things in the Christian life, we need to strive for that balance, because exercise is like many things, they can be extreme. So on the one hand, we could become so focused on our spiritual lives and spiritual disciplines that we actually can neglect our bodies. But on the other end of the spectrum, we can be so focused on exercise and health and diets and perhaps the appearance of our body, the fitness of our body, that becomes a priority at the expense of really focusing on the things of the Spirit and cultivating Christ-likeness and praying and reading the Word. So what Paul is actually pointing out here is that we need to get this balance, and he's correctly helped us to see that exercise does profit us And we know that, I mean, obviously through through science and the articles that we come across regularly, we can see all of the ways that physical activity enhances our well-being, enhances our immunity and the functioning of our body. Mm. But what is more important is the pursuit of godliness. And we've mentioned on previous programs the verse that says to set our minds on the eternal and not to be so concerned with the temporal. It is important, but our focus always needs to be on the fact that we are heavenly citizens and that is our eternal home, and be striving to that without neglecting our bodies. But there is a verse that's actually really helpful as well when it comes to understanding that physical exercise and the stewardship of our bodies is important, and that's in 1 Corinthians, and it's 1 Corinthians 6 and it's verses 19 and 20, and it says, "Do you not know that your body is the temple of the Holy Spirit who is in you, whom you have from God, and you are not your own, for you were bought at a price? Therefore glorify God in your body and in your spirit, which are God's." I really like that, because it really helps us to understand that our bodies belong to God, that they're given to us to steward and to look after, because God's spirit resides within us. So some thoughts that we can come back to perhaps in part two, but a few thoughts anyway.
Wonderful.
Yeah. Well, Richard, on that note, why don't we go to our worship song before we turn to the newspapers? This is a really, really beautiful worship song by a Christian duo called Mary Mary. It's called Shackles. It's really lovely. We'll be back with you in a few moments to talk about what we're waking up to in the newspapers.
I'm gonna praise.
Welcome back to Our Mornings. Mary, Mary, singing Shackles there. I just want to praise you. A really lovely way to begin the program. And in this part, we are turning to the daily newspapers, beginning with what is featuring on the front covers. We're starting with the Daily Telegraph, and leading on the front page of the Daily Telegraph is the story, "The solar boom is over in the UK." Britain's solar boom is over after ministers announced yesterday they would offer virtually no incentive for people to install panels on their homes. In a surprise move, ministers said that they plan to slash the subsidy paid towards household electricity bills. Under the new proposals, the amount paid to homeowners under the feed-in tariff from next year will fall by nearly 90%. There is a photo with the title, "The Man Who Brought Down Bolt." Usain Bolt surged to a thrilling win over Justin Gatlin in the 200 metres at the Beijing World Championships yesterday, but met a far tougher foe on his victory lap in the form of a cameraman who lost control of his Segway scooter with disastrous results. And we can see the photo there. Also on the front page of the Telegraph, "Peerage for Shamed Moat Expenses MP." David Cameron was last night accused of bringing Parliament into disrepute by handing a life peerage to Douglas Hogg, the former Tory MP who quit the Commons in disgrace over an expenses claim for his moat.
Right, and now moving on to the Times now. Front page of the Times, we've got first another picture of Usain Bolt, poor chap, knocked over by a cameraman. The main headline is "High-tech plan to save ancient sites from ISIS. Oxford and Harvard monument men launch fight back against jihadists." A team of digital aid monument men are to launch an unprecedented fight back against the destruction of ancient sites in the Middle East by Islamic State. Archaeologists at Oxford and Harvard University will flood the region with 3D cameras in a plan to create a full digital record of every threatened artifact. If the treasures they photograph are destroyed by ISIS, the academics will harness 3D printing technology to reconstruct them in the same style as the original antiquities. And finally, MPs caught in expenses row awarded peerages. More than a dozen former MPs were handed peerages yesterday despite being caught out in the expenses scandal. Among them was a Tory grandee who billed taxpayers for cleaning the moat on his country estate. David Cameron was accused of an expensive insult to the public as he gave honours to friends and allies, including 14 Downing Street staff, and peerages to 5 former special advisers and 2 party donors. That's the front page of the Times.
And on the front page of the Daily Mail is the story, "As numbers break all records, migrants, how many more can we take?" The true scale of the immigration crisis was laid bare last night as damning figures revealed net migration had surged to a record 330,000, a rise of 40% in 1 year. It is a humiliating blow to David Cameron after his no ifs, no buts pledge to reduce the number to tens of thousands. Incredibly, yesterday's figures do not include illegal immigrants in the UK, estimated at 1.1 million. There's also a photo of Jamie Oliver pictured with his wife Jules, and the title reads, "Jamie's War on Junk Food Ads in TV Talent Shows." Just to highlight a bit more of that article in the Daily Mail, it says here, "Jamie Oliver hit out yesterday at the junk food adverts that are shown during breaks in family shows like The X Factor and Britain's Got Talent. The celebrity chef said children are bombarded with commercials for products such as sugary drinks during peak slots."
And finally, we come back to the front page of Daily Express now. The main headline is "Antibiotics Raise Risk of Diabetes." I'll read it to you and then tell you that I'm not totally impressed by this article. People who take too many antibiotics could be at risk of developing diabetes. A shocking new study suggests there is a clear link between the disease and the number of times a patient is prescribed the drugs. Those given 5 or more prescriptions over as many as 15 years are up to 53% more likely to develop type 2 diabetes than those given antibiotics just once or never, scientists have found. Well, I'll give you I used to be a GP for 28 years and I used to have a diabetic clinic with 300 patients. Now the thing is that we're not either diabetics or not diabetics. There's a huge class of pre-diabetics. people who have slightly raised blood sugar, but they're not actually classified as diabetes according to the official guidelines issued by NICE. Anyway, the thing is that a raised blood sugar of any sort will make you more predisposed to having infections. So I suspect what actually, rather than the antibiotics are causing diabetes, the fact is that people with pre-diabetes, in other words, slightly raised blood sugar but not actually over the threshold, are more prone to get infections, and that's why they have antibiotics. That's just the skeptical Dr. Richard having his little say there. And the other thing on the front page of the Daily Express is Kirsty Gallagher waltzes into Strictly. I'll just read a bit more about that on page 3. Strictly Come Dancing completed its new season celebrity lineup yesterday with two stars from sport. Sky Sports news presenter Kirsty Gallagher left, joins along with former Olympic sprinter Ewan Thomas, age 42. Their participation was announced as they appeared on BBC's The One Show, where Kirsty, aged 39, declared, "Sport and fitness have always been a big part of my life, but dancing is an entirely new challenge for me. I can't wait." So there we are. That concludes our look at the front pages of the papers.
Thank you, Richard. So why don't we begin our review of some of the articles that we've come across in the papers this morning. And I thought it would be really good to start off with the articles highlighting what we can expect for the bank holiday weekend, because this is the last bank holiday weekend before Christmas. And there are some things that we're being forewarned about. It's not the best news, but it is good to be forewarned. So the first article was in the Daily Telegraph this morning, and it's highlighting a train strike. A train strike and cheap petrol, and it's saying that for these reasons we'll see an extra 14 million cars on the roads this bank holiday. Says here, rail strikes and the falling cost of petrol will encourage up to 50% more people to travel by car this weekend compared to the August bank holiday last year. Analysis shows train services will be heavily disrupted in the southwest if staff at the First Great Western carry out threats to walk out for 3 days from Saturday. And the operator has failed to reach an agreement with the Rail, Maritime and Transport Union, which disputes the introduction of new high-speed trains. The RAC expects an extra 14 million vehicles on the roads as families enjoy the last long weekend before Christmas. The article also highlights a decrease in petrol price. It says here petrol prices are now 24p a litre lower than the bank holiday weekend of 2014, on average making a round trip from St Albans, Hertfordshire to Cornwall around £20 cheaper. So there we go. So a little bit about the road. So 14 million more extra people on the roads expected, which is not the best news for you, Richard, is it? Because you're going away. Do you want to share about your holiday? Because it sounds really lovely.
Oh, well, my wife and I are very keen on walking in the Lake District. So we've done it once this year and we stay in a little log cabin. So we're going back again for some more. Walking in the Lake District, that's what we like best.
Well, that's lovely. And I hope that you're going to benefit from nice weather. This article's saying maybe it won't get off to the best start. This is in the Daily Mail, and it's saying here, bank holiday break, make sure you bring your brolly as rain and blustery conditions are predicted for much of the country. Mind you, Richard, it's just for the bank holiday weekend, so it might get better over the holiday. But it says, if you're loading up your car today to head off for the bank holiday weekend, make sure you leave room for a sturdy umbrella. The unsettled weather that has so far made August a month to forget will continue over the next few days. Rain and blustery conditions are expected across much of the country, with clearer skies arriving only by Monday, just as families return home. And it just goes on to talk about temperatures struggling to get higher than 22 degrees for much of the weekend, adding to the impression of a washout summer, but they're expected to peak on Sunday at around 23 degrees. So it's just saying that we haven't enjoyed a hot sunny day since last Saturday. But anyway, as I read this, I thought about that verse in the Bible that says that this is the day that the Lord has made. We will rejoice and be glad in it, because our God is sovereign and good, and he has control of the weather, and he has a purpose in all things. So we can rejoice and be glad no matter if it's raining or sunny. We have something to praise him for.
Well, I've got another verse to add. Actually, we always say this before we go on holiday: the sun shines on the righteous.
Oh, I love
that. The sun shines on the righteous. We always quote that, and the sun always shines whenever we go on holiday.
That's wonderful. Well, actually, Richard, it would be great now to turn to the effects of the Chinese stock market crash, because I know this is something that you're following closely. There is an article in the Daily Telegraph, which I'll highlight as well before we cover this. But just to say, actually, that we've received an email from Diane in China, actually. She's saying here, hi, in China, the government are demanding that all crosses are to be removed from churches, and a priest has gone missing. Also, in the last few days, the stock market in China has gone into free fall. And she's saying this is not a coincidence. Our God will not be mocked. God bless you both. Amen. So that's quite interesting to receive that just as we're about to cover the story. Diane, thank you so much for your message this morning. Just to say to all of the viewers, do keep your emails and texts coming in. It is always so lovely to hear from you on the program. Email us about any of the stories that we're covering and your thoughts on Christians and exercise. So Richard, getting back to the story, the article in the Daily Telegraph today was actually on reflation. I've never heard of that term before, reflation.
Here,
reflation threat to bonds as money supply catches fire in Europe. And the title, subtitle says here, central banks are taking out loose money insurance against a crisis in China, but they risk being caught badly off guard by surging money growth as stimulus bites. So your thoughts, Richard?
Okay, well, this article is headed reflation, which is a very polite word for printing money. In other words, it's QE. But they don't like to use the word QE or printing money, so they're using this word reflation. Basically, in the European Central Bank are printing 60 billion euros every month, and that is an awful lot of money. And the other extraordinary thing is that the government bonds, sovereign bonds, are now in negative territory. I'll just read you the actual figures, if I can actually find them. The yields on, so the government raised money by basically selling bonds. The yields on Europe's sovereign bonds are still at historic lows, priced for depression as far as the eye can see. Two-year yields are negative in 14 countries, including Ireland, Slovenia, Latvia, and the Czech Republic. 10-year yields are 1% in France, 0.74% in Germany, and minus 0.17% in Switzerland. So let me just ask you, would you lend your money to any European country at a negative interest rate over a 10-year period when they're printing money at the rate of 60 billion euros a month? Well, I'll tell you what, I wouldn't, but there you are. That's just my thoughts.
So, Richard, the effects of the Chinese stock market crash, I know that you have a video that you're also wanting to highlight.
Probably best to show the video first, if it's possible.
Sure.
I don't know if we could show that video of the Chinese stock market crash, which, of course, has affected all the markets all over the world. And the Chinese stock market has been crashing, actually, for the last 2 months, but now is in free fall, as our viewer just pointed out. But if we can see that video on the Chinese stock market, which is affecting all markets. It's now affecting the Dow Jones and the FTSE and the CAC and the DAX and all the other major stock markets. And while we're waiting for that, I'll just give you a preview. So as you can see, 3.2 trillion has been wiped off world equity markets or shares since the China devalued their currency just by 2%. Basically, the world's the stock markets are in meltdown. There was a slight bounce in the last few days, but the trend is definitely down, according to all major commentators. And I thought I'd just read you the comments by Richard Russell. I don't know if you've ever heard of Richard Russell. He's in his 90s now, but he's widely considered to be the best financial newsletter writer in the world, and he's also a Christian. And this is what he has to say. These are general emails which he sends to members of the public. Richard Russell's Dow Theory letter, worst bear market in history. I've been writing Dow Theory letters since 1958, and I've never let my subscribers take losses in a primary bear market. I believe we are now in a primary bear market that will go down in history as the worst bear market that we have ever experienced. My subscribers are completely out of stocks and are holding physical silver and gold. I believe this bear market will touch or break below previous historic lows. The collapse of stocks will generate great confusion amongst Americans. Well, the fact is that all of us hold stocks to a degree, even if you don't personally hold stocks, in our pensions. If you've got a pension, then a lot of that is in stocks or bonds. Now, bonds is something I want to talk about because basically the world is absolutely swimming in debt, and that is the underlying problem. The problems in China are related to the fact that they had an enormous boom fueled by credit, not only from the Chinese central bank, but also from a secondary market in credit where families lend money to other families, mostly in property. And the Chinese property market has imploded. In fact, they've got about 12 ghost cities, which nobody's living in them. Basically, people have borrowed huge multiples, like 70 times their income, to buy apartments in these high-rise apartment blocks all over China. 70 times, and I thought it was high in England, but it's up to 11 times in England. But in China, it's up to 70 times, which means people take mortgages over several generations. And of course, that's what we call geared money. In other words, borrowed money is geared. So if the primary asset, in this case, property, goes down, then the investors take a huge loss. But what is really worrying isn't actually the stock market, but the bond market, because this world lives on debt. Everything that you and I buy, houses, cars, everything is bought on credit. Even if you use a credit card to buy stuff in your supermarket, you're using credit. And what's more, the supermarket themselves, they use credit to get their supplies in. Everything runs on credit. And remember, God doesn't like debt of any sort. In fact, in the Old Testament, in the book of Leviticus, all debt is wiped out every 50 years. So God's best advice is in Romans 12, owe no man anything save to love one another. Anyway, that's enough about the stock market, and we'll move on.
Richard, it's just really helpful to get your updates as we read these stories, because there are a lot of viewers who are actually writing and asking thoughts on this, so it is really helpful for you to be offering this feedback. Thank you so much. And we've received a number of messages in the meantime, actually some about our upcoming topic. The first is from John from Cumbria. John, thank you so much for your message this morning. John's saying about the worship song we played, Shackles, it's a tune that I warm up to. I am a sports therapist and a fitness instructor. I believe many who don't like exercise criticize those who do, and they'll look for any excuse not to. But it's more than that. I believe in holistic health, not just exercise. I look forward to seeing both of you on Revelation TV. God bless, from John. John, that is absolutely wonderful to hear from you. And I have to say, I'm so encouraged by that, because I pray and ask God about which worship songs to include. And I was thinking of going with another one, but that was the one that he showed me. So that's amazing that you're a fitness instructor and that you use that as part of your warming up. So that's really, really great. And also really helpful to get your input about that from your experience, you find that those who actually don't like exercise criticize those who do. So that's an interesting point. To be really good to get other people's thoughts on that, but really wonderful to hear from you, John. Thank you. And a couple of other messages, Richard. One from Sam, who has asked for prayer. Sam says, please pray everything goes well with my house move and my college course, and I will get my qualification next next year and for financial blessing to cover my costs with the move and college. God richly bless you both from Sam. Sam, it will be so lovely to pray for you in part two. And what an exciting time as the academic year is about to begin. And all the very best to you. May God's blessings be with you and your studies over the coming year. And we'll certainly pray for you. Thank you for your message. And another one just for the meantime. This is from Joyce, who says, blessings to you. All physical activity helps you to relax muscles and have a healthy glow. I have found at the age of 73, this can be achieved by a brisk 15-minute walk as many times as possible. And Joyce is pointing out the Epistle to John, the third Epistle to John, chapter 2. I've got the verse here, actually. Chapter 1, verse 2, and it says, Beloved, I pray that you may prosper in all things and be in health just as your soul prospers. So, Joyce, that is wonderful to be encouraged by that verse. We love hearing the way that Bible verses encourage each of you when it comes to the topics we're covering. So that's a great verse, Joyce, and really helpful what you've said, that even a brisk 15-minute walk really helps with that healthy glow and relaxing the muscles. Really inspiring. Richard, what do you think about what Joyce has
shared? I think it's wonderful, dear Joyce. She's 73 and she's very active, and that's absolutely wonderful, and top marks for Joyce.
Yeah. Well, actually, we can carry on that theme, because the next article featured a day or so ago, it's a centenarian, an 100-year-old man, Joseph, who says that exercise and three meals a day and a few vitamins is the key to a long life. This is so inspiring, this story. Mm. I just really love it. There's a picture of Joe here. He's 100 and he's taking part in a fall prevention class at Oldham Sports Centre. It says here, a centenarian who says exercise is the key to a long life is showing youngsters how it's done during twice weekly exercise sessions. Mm. Joe Littlewood, 100, swears by three meals a day, a few vitamins and regular exercise. And since starting the falls prevention exercise classes, his daughter Winifred and son Terence have noticed he is much steadier on his feet. We're seeing some photos of Joe coming up on screen. Winifred said, when my mum passed away last year, it was a shock for my dad to be on his own, and the classes have helped him to meet other elderly people in a similar position. But he's always kept active. He regularly bowled until he was 90, when arthritis in his knees became too painful, and he loved gardening too. He must have good genes, but he's never smoked, drinks very little, and keeps himself very well. He has three meals a day, and it seems to be down to a healthy lifestyle. It says here, World War II soldier Joe turned 100 earlier this month and celebrated with his family and friends at Bickerton Court Sheltered Housing. And he was a former finance manager, and he's taking part in these 45-minute exercise sessions. And he says, I really enjoy the classes and meeting people there, and they are good for your health. So really, really wonderful advice from Joe, 100 years old, and I have to say he looks so vibrant and vital.
He doesn't look 100, actually. He looks absolutely really fit, doesn't he? He looks really well. And he's exercising every day, and he's getting lots of oxygen pumping around his body, and particularly to his brain, which is the computer that controls all of our body. And that the one thing that our brains love is oxygen. And the more exercise we do, the more oxygen gets to the brain. Wow. So there we are.
That's really wonderful. It was interesting that the instructor of this class, I think, is quoted as saying that she's had three women who reached 100 take part in her classes, but I think this was the first man. So Joe's doing very, very well. And as you say, he looks really vital and healthy. It's really wonderful.
He does.
So a bit of inspiration when it comes to exercise. And Richard, we have this really, really great video to go to now. It's just a bit of fun. Just to let you know about it, this was a video that Anne Dawson, a lovely Anne in Tula, played out at the very beginning of the year. And when I saw it, I just thought it was so funny that I probably watched it about 100 times at that time, because it was just so well done. But as we're talking about exercise today, this is just a bit of fun to add to our discussion. A few ideas when it comes to integrating more activity into our worship. We'll go to this video now and be back with you really soon.
Hey everybody, welcome to church. We got about 5 minutes before the service starts, so here are some church-appropriate dance moves you can do whenever the Spirit moves you. So get on up and let's sweat to some scriptures. Or maybe not, or just let's go. Here we go. One, two, three, four. Shirts on the face. See it on the face. Yeah. Bring it together. Here we go. Let it go. You take the stone, you let it go. You're unhindered by armor. Let that elbow sway. Elbow, 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 elbow. Okay. One of my personal favorites. Resurrection. You gotta get down to get back. Yeah. Keep working it, guys. Keep working it. You're doing great. I'm doing great. I'm getting a little tired. We gotta stomp hard, stomp hard, stomp hard. You're crushing it, crushing it, crushing it. Yeah. Okay. Good break there, good break. Good job, guys. Here we go, ready? Get that whip going. Scare those tax collectors, those merchants. Yeah. Merchants. Make sure you look afraid. And this is salt. You look back and salt, salt, salt. Oh boy, we're kind of getting to you. You're doing great, everybody. Almost. Okay, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. 2 minutes, 30 seconds left. Here we go. Close again. 1, 2, 3, 4.
Service. So well done. A bit of fun there. Church appropriate dance moves, how to involve a bit more activity into worship. Really, really funny. We hope that you enjoy that video this morning. At this stage, we're going to go to our next story. And if you were with us last week, you may remember that we were looking at the sounds of creation and the way that Louis Giglio is actually interpreting this as a form of worship to God based on the Psalms. And so we're just going to carry on a little bit with that, because Richard and I were talking afterwards and he mentioned about the way that the universe actually creates a sound. So before Richard speaks more about that, just to read a bit more of the psalm about how all creation, all the universe praises the Lord. So this is from Psalm 148, and just the first few verses it says, praise the Lord from the heavens, praise him in the heights, praise him all his angels, praise him all his hosts, praise him sun and moon, praise him all you stars of light, praise him you heavens of heavens and you waters above the heavens. And it goes on from there, Richard, a really lovely way to begin this discussion on the sounds of the universe.
Yes, absolutely. Yeah. Well, I think last week we were talking about whales, as you correctly said, and I think we were just about to hear the sounds of the universe taken by the Hubble Space Telescope. So here we go. Sounds of the universe. Welcome back. And as you can see, the universe is a very noisy place. Not surprising. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. And remember, on planet Earth, we're whizzing through space at 70,000 miles an hour. Seriously fast. And we're also spinning around on the equator at 10,000 miles an hour on the equator. And of course, it makes a noise. But of course, the space is actually full of comets and asteroids and all sorts of other planets and stars, and it's all making a wonderful noise. And according to Psalm 148, it's the whole universe praising God. Isn't that wonderful, Beckett?
Richard, I thought that was so lovely how you actually thought to about the fact that the universe itself actually creates a sound, and how we can actually see that as a form of worship to God. It's actually just, it's really lovely to have that encouragement. So thank you for that. And there are a few other stories that would be great to highlight before we go to part two. This was a story that I came across, and I thought it's very well timed because all of the children are going back to school. I think next week school begins again for the next academic year. And apparently it's a very, very difficult time for parents to get their children to sleep this first week when they go back to school. So there was this article in the Daily Mail today, and it says here, the recipe for perfect bedtime story. It says here, the ideal tale lasts 8.5 minutes, and it includes a dragon, a princess, a wizard, and a fairy, research reveals. It says, the perfect bedtime story lasts 8.5 minutes and includes all of those things. And such knowledge might just come in handy because the survey that was carried out found that parents spend a total of 1 week a year trying to get their children to go to sleep. While the ideal story lasting 8 minutes and 36 seconds might have traditional elements, such as the backdrop of a castle, the hero should carry a thoroughly modern mobile phone as well as a magic wand. And it says, a strong friendship must develop between characters, and there has to be a scary moment in which the hero faces danger when he or she fights the baddie. And of course, the main character must defeat the evil villain and live happily ever after. And it goes on from there saying that the study by holiday camp company Butlins as part of their new Just for Tots breaks highlighted how difficult mums and dads find getting their children to sleep when they start school again following the summer break. So Richard, did you and Val have trouble getting your daughters were young, getting them off to sleep when they started school?
They never went to sleep. We had a special gate at the top of the stairs, sort of keep them in the pen, as it were, on the top of the stairs, but they were running around all night as far as I was concerned.
So did you read stories to them?
Oh, yes, absolutely, yes, all sorts of stories. Yeah. In fact, one of them would only go to sleep if I was actually sleeping on the carpet next to them.
Oh, wow.
But then I used to go to sleep and wake up and find the child had gone.
I just think it's really lovely reading about this because I can remember so vividly the stories that were read to me when I was a child. It's really interesting how clearly some of those memories are from childhood.
Were they similar sort of stories?
Well, I was just thinking about that. Yeah, in part they were. I did enjoy the stories of princesses and knights and fairies. And also Mum had a lot of Bible stories as well, which I really loved. It was really good that we grew up having those. Like, we had those illustrated Bibles for children,
yes,
which
wonderful.
Were really, really good. And my mum had all of these value books where it would take certain fruit of the spirit or certain Christian values, and it would explore the life of a person of history who really demonstrated these values, and it was all kind of animated. So there were a whole series of these books that Mum would read to us as well, which I really enjoyed too. They really do stay with you, those stories that are read to you as children, I think.
That's wonderful.
And lullabies.
Lullabies as well. Yeah.
Yeah, so that's really some encouragement to parents if your children are starting back at school and you're wondering about ways to help them get off to sleep. Hopefully that was inspiring to you this morning. And a few more stories before part two. Now, Richard, this is one that we were hoping to get to for the past couple of weeks, and it's all about working out and how music is so helpful as we do workouts at gyms. So just to read a bit of this, and I'd love to get your feedback on it, it says, why it is easier to work out to music. Tunes help dull the pain of exercise by producing chemicals similar to morphine. It says here, gym goers have known for years that working out is easier to music. Now scientists think they know the reason why. It seems that listening to our favourite tunes helps reduce pain. Listening to music makes our brain release natural pain-killing chemicals called opioids, the same family of drugs as heroin and morphine. It seems that these chemicals are why the music has such a powerful effect on our well-being and makes exercising less agonising. And other beneficial effects of music include boosting our immune system and reviving memories, even in some with Alzheimer's disease, the article suggests. So, Richard, I know that you are an avid gym goer and that you listen to music, teaching, all kinds of things as you work out. Did you relate to the article?
Absolutely, yes, absolutely. Well, we've talked, Berg and I have talked about this business before. When you exercise, your body releases endorphins, which, as the article says, they're very similar to morphine. And it has an extraordinary effect on your brain, feeling good and euphoric. and basically feeling very well, and you almost get a sort of high, but it's a very healthy high. It's not a high like a sugar high, it's not a high like an alcohol high, and it's certainly not like a drug high. It's a very health high. I have to be honest that when I was younger, I used to be addicted to long distance running, and I would go running 10 miles a day and run all sorts of races with friends. And in fact, I'll just show you. Those are all marathon and half marathon medals, because I was absolutely addicted to running because of the feeling you got afterwards, endorphins giving you a buzz, a feel-good buzz, which basically a better feeling than almost anything, really. What do you think, Birgit?
Yeah, that's interesting. Well, I have to say that that's a very, very impressive bunch of medals that you have here. That's amazing, actually, that you took part in that many races. You're saying that it's just for participating, though, isn't it?
Oh, it's not for winning. I wasn't a very good runner. If you complete a marathon, which is 26 miles, you get a medal.
But still, that's brilliant. That's brilliant, Richard. And I love what you're saying about endorphins. And it is really interesting with that. From memory, it comes through high intensity exercise for long duration, so 50 to 60 minutes consistently. So for those who take part in high impact exercise, cardiovascular exercise, so running obviously, or exercise to music classes, and as I say, for 50 to 60 minutes, and they do this regularly, people in that category are shown to have high proportions of endorphins in the bloodstream. And as you say, that it has a kind of a narcotic effect.
It does.
And it does create a sense of euphoria, actually, and people that actually then stop exercising for whatever reason have what seem to be withdrawal symptoms, so they can suffer kind of irritability or feelings of guilt or tension from not maintaining that kind of level of exercise and having really that kind of rush that comes with this particular protein. Endorphins are a protein, but this is something different. The opioids that it mentioned, it seems to be that, and there's dopamine as well, serotonin, all of these sort of chemicals and proteins released into the bloodstream.
Exactly. Yeah. Absolutely right.
And all natural as well. So.
Oh yes, all very, very healthy.
Yes.
And you can get absolutely seriously addicted, I mean I was, to the endorphins. In fact, if I didn't run 10 miles a day, I felt, you know, life was dreadful, you know.
Yes.
So I've made sure I did, you know.
Well, apparently psychologists suggest that for people who suffer or are prone to depression or anxiety, that actually by doing high intensity forms of exercise, it's actually a really helpful way to counter that, which is quite interesting, and it's obviously for these reasons. Yes.
Well, I went through a period of stress and everything else, and I definitely found that exercise worked better than any medication or anything else like that. The only other thing that worked really well was praise. I found that praise worked even better than exercise.
Wow. Well, I know that we're going to return to these sorts of themes in our discussion coming up in part two, which is wonderful. We've received a few more messages that would be great to read out before we go to our break. And the first is from Maureen, who says, my husband, who is 80, and I, who am 77, do what is called super slow exercise. And she says that you can see this on YouTube. This method strengthens the muscles without taxing the joints. It also involves deep breathing. Therefore, it's good for the heart and circulation. It is undertaken once a week for 20 minutes with a personal trainer. It was of such value to me before knee replacement, and my muscles were so much stronger to hold to my new joint. Thank you, Lord. Shalom from Maureen. Maureen, what an encouraging message to receive, and really inspiring that you and your husband take part in this particular exercise form called super slow exercise and the benefits that you've received from it. It's really wonderful to get these ideas coming in, and hopefully it will be helpful to other viewers who are watching as well. Richard, what are your thoughts?
I must look this up on the internet about this slow exercise. I'm very interested in that.
Oh, that's wonderful. We'll see if we can fit in one more before our break. It says, thanks for your uplifting program this morning. Please would you pray for our youngest son, who is hoping to move house today, only to be told that it won't be happening due to a paperwork mistake. Please pray at this difficult time. Would you pray for a miracle? God is able when we are not. Love as always, Pete and Jen. Pete and Jen, we would be delighted to pray for your son, and we do believe in a miracle working God, so we're going to pray that he makes a way, or that he will use this for unexpected good. We'll certainly pray in part two. In the meantime, do stay tuned. When we return, we'll be talking about this topic of Christians and exercise, and how important should exercise be for Christians. Do keep your thoughts coming in. If you have any testimonies, Bible verses, we'd love to hear from you. And in the meantime, enjoy the break, and we'll be back with you very soon.